Let's pray. Let's commit this time, commit ourselves into God's hands. And let's do that. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this time. We commit ourselves into your mighty hands, Lord. Lord, we just ask that you would speak. Lord, we pray that you would lead. Father God, we thank you that you're the one who releases your gifts and releases the call on each one of us. And I pray that, Lord, even as you do so, may we be, Lord, strengthened, may we be empowered. Lord, I pray that that you will add to our lives, Lord, line upon line and precept upon precept, Lord. And I pray that, Lord, in all this, God, that the objective will be, Lord, fruitfulness and a desire to bring glory to your name, Lord, and to be pleasing to you, Lord, in all that we think and say and do, Father God, in our lives individually and also collectively as teams, as churches, Lord, as ministry teams. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for this time you've given us. We pray that you'll speak to us, Lord. We give you all the praise and all the glory at this time. In Jesus' Master's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. Yeah. It's really, you know, even as we've been going through this course, I think last class we looked at this whole aspect of team decision making, right? Team decision making. And we looked at several ways by which we can do. First of all, we looked at what decision making was and why, you know, we need to learn about decision making and how important decision making is, right? Even for our own lives, we either consciously or, you know, without being conscious of it, we make decisions all along. Like right from morning till we are awake, till we go to bed, we make thousands of, you know, hundreds of decisions, if not thousands, right? Hundreds of decisions every day. And more so as spiritual leaders and also as ministry leaders, right? People in ministry, we make decisions. So it's important for us to understand the consequences of decisions, and which might be great, which might be good, and also, you know, bad decisions will have bad consequences. Now, certain decisions may not affect our lives that greatly, and it's fine. You know, it's fine if you have coffee or tea, right, in the morning, and you say, okay, I don't want either coffee nor tea. I don't want that. It's not going to affect you in any big way or your ministry in any way just because you chose coffee over tea, or you chose not to have, you know, coffee or tea that morning. It's not going to affect you. But then there are certain decisions which will affect you, your family, maybe your ministry. So it's important that we arrive at, we learn how to make good decisions or decisions which are impactful. Right? And the best part is that we have God's Spirit in us, indwelling us, and He's given us His Word. So we have a fail-safe. Right, he's there to check. He's there to check our motives, check our alert us when we, you know, we are about to make these mistakes. If we are, you know, open to Him and surrender to Him and obedient to His voice, then He will lead us in wisdom, in His wisdom. Right. Okay. So last class we looked at team decision making. You know, now how do as a team. You know, we always, most times we work in teams. We work together in teams, and that's how it is, right? So how do I make decisions as a team? So we looked at that. You know, we could be making the decisions just by myself, and that has its advantages and disadvantages. Or it is just two people in the group which are making decisions for the group. So that has advantages and disadvantages as well. So we looked at several ways by which we can arrive at, you know, decision making, which will benefit the group, and also the team will also feel part of it, feel a part of that decision making. So that's very important, right? Because the team can, like, maybe some important decision is made, but it involves the entire team carrying it out, right? It's not okay just that decision is made, but the entire team should be able to carry it out. So that is possible only if the team has bought into that decision or made a commitment saying, Yes, I will do this. Now, the team may not make that commitment if a decision was made for them, a very important decision. Let's say a decision is all guys should wear ties, right? Shirt and ties, and maybe ladies should wear saris when they come to work. Now, the thing is, it's not very convenient, right? It's not comfortable to dress up like that every day. But let's say somebody made the decision. Now, what will the commitment be? The commitment of the team to show up at work dressed formally like that. It may not be great, right? The team might complain, say, every day, how can I come like that? It's not necessary. It's not. So they may not be committed to it, or the team would feel very demotivated. They will do it, but they don't really enjoy. Because maybe some work would involve carrying things, moving stuff, and you're sweating, and it's not really comfortable to be like that, to be dressed like that, and doing the work. Right? So, the commitment to carrying out the decision by the team is important. So we looked at that also. How do I arrive at that? So we looked at a couple of videos last. So this today, in continuing with that topic, we're going to look at two main things. That is, what will help us, as a team, to come to certain decisions, and also to come up with some good ideas, right? So this is a video on brainstorming. So we looked at, making decision that works. We looked at that video, and today's video is on brainstorming, and really a very simple process, effective process. We studied about brainstorming, but this is an effective process on how to do that, how to practically do that, right? So let me just share that. We'll watch this video and then we'll talk about it some more. Okay. Just give me a minute.
Hi, I'm Ed Musio, CEO of Groupharmonics. I'm going to tell you about brainstorming done right. We hear the word brainstorming used around the workplace a lot. And usually, now, we just use it to mean everyone share your idea. But everyone can share their ideas by email. The idea of real brainstorming is we have a group of people, like this group here. The whole is greater than the sum of the parts. In other words, they can do more together than they could do alone. The way brainstorming is supposed to work is that we get this group together. This person shares an idea he has, maybe, with these people. Maybe she hears that idea, gives her another idea, gives this person another idea. They all start talking back and forth about their different ideas. And eventually, this person hears all that, and it inspires this person to have an idea that nobody else had. In a sense, it's this person's idea. But in a sense, this great idea came from everything that came before it. That's real brainstorming. Now, if you want to do your brainstorming right and get ideas you wouldn't otherwise get, there are some simple do's and don'ts that you need to follow. The first do for good brainstorming is you do want to capture everything, and I mean everything. You want to start a flip chart, or maybe a whiteboard, and you want to write down everything anyone says, no matter how crazy it sounds. You may be inclined to skip some things, but you don't want to do that. You want to get everything on the board. What you don't want to do is you don't want to evaluate anything. You don't want to say, that'll never work, that's too expensive, and not write it down. This may not be a useful idea, but it may inspire the next useful idea, so you want it up. Now, the next thing you want to do in good brainstorming is you want to encourage participation. It's perfectly valid to turn to someone and say, Frank, I haven't heard from you in a while. Do you have any new ideas? Maybe Frank has something he's been thinking about. On the other hand, what you don't want to do is you never want to force participation or participation sequence. If you're just going to make everyone go around the table and say what they think, you've lost the organic nature of the process and you're back to using email. Don't force it. The third thing you want to do in proper brainstorming is you want to allow people to ask clarifying questions. Let's say, for example, that you said your idea was to change the business process. I might ask you, do you mean the accounting business process, or do you mean the customer service business process? That's a clarifying question. I'm trying to understand what your idea really is. What we never want to do is we never want to allow anyone to ask judging questions. It wouldn't be appropriate for me to say to you, how could you possibly think that would work? That's a judging question. It's really a secret way of just evaluating, and it's too soon in the process for evaluating. Now, once you've gotten through that part of the process, once you've got your full list and everyone's best ideas are out, Then you can start to evaluate. Actually, you're going to do three things. First, you're going to categorize. You're going to find like items, and you're going to group them together so you can reduce the number of things you have to study. Then you're going to reduce. You're going to go through and find the things that just won't work. You know they're not feasible, and you're going to take them off the list. And then finally, you're going to analyze. You're going to look at what's left, figure out which are the best ideas, and bring them forward, hopefully, for implementation. So the next time you have a group of people and you need a great idea, do your brainstorming right. Capture everything everyone says, encourage participation, and make sure you allow clarifying questions. But don't evaluate anything too soon in the process. Don't force people to participate or their order, and don't ask judging questions. Once you've got your list together, then you can categorize, reduce, and analyze what you have. And hopefully what you'll find there will include your next great idea.
Okay. So just want to ask us, you know, how many of you have been part of a brainstorming process? You know, sharing ideas. Let's say somebody has. How many of you have actually done this? Maybe part of a brainstorming exercise. Anyone? Okay, so you've not been part of this, okay, or facilitated brainstorming. Okay, we're just calling it brainstorming. You know, it's just a process to generate ideas, right? So so one thing is for us to know that. We need collectively, we need ideas, more ideas, right, in order to be effective as a team. And sometimes, you know, we're doing certain things, we need to change the way we work. And in order to be effective, we need to find solutions to problems, right? And maybe you're leading a team and you need to find solutions. Okay. Let's say, typically, what kind of problems do you think we can find solutions for as a team? You know, you can talk from your experience, maybe as working in a group, or maybe it can be something that you're doing right now. What kind of challenges would be there that the team needs to solve? Okay, what do you think? What kind of challenges? Maybe we can just write down a couple of those. Anyone? Sid, like in your line of work, like whatever you're doing right now, you know, what kind of challenge would be there where you need to, you know, get the team together and say, okay, let's think, let's solve this. Any particular challenge specifically you can think of? Okay, Aaron says a different idea. Okay, so a different idea for what, Aaron? Specifically?
Yeah, suppose, if we are planning something or if we're just for occasion or something like that. So everyone has a different view of idea, no? So, so I was talking about that, yeah.
Okay, so maybe your organizing, okay, I'll just put that, organizing an event, planning for an event. Now, when I say event, it could be, it could be a ministry event, it could be a business event, it could be anything, right? It could be a social thing for the family, like organizing an event, planning for an event. So then, you know, you don't want to do it the same way. You know, this is how we've done all these years and you want to do it a little differently. So then definitely, you know, you personally can come out with some, you know, three ideas, four ideas, you know, depending on how difficult or challenging the thing is. But when you have a group of, let's say, five others who are with you in that group, then definitely more ideas can be generated. You know, more ideas, people will share more ideas. Right? Like Kiran says, many ideas can come together. Yeah, that's true. So now the thing is, can we have a process for people to have ideas, share ideas? No, that's one. That's important. Can there be a process? Because otherwise it'll be chaotic, right? People saying that, hey, my idea is not, I keep giving these ideas, but nobody does anything about it. So you need to have a process in place and an understanding, right? That collectively, there will be a decision taken. Collectively, we will share ideas, but we will evaluate them. And then we will act on this. We will select one idea or maybe two things, and then we will move forward with it. Right. So the video that we saw was talking about that, where you have a group, let's say, of five people. So organizing an event, planning for an event. Okay. So you ask everybody to list down ideas. Okay. To share ideas. So you, as a facilitator or a leader, now, maybe you have a whiteboard, or you're taking it down in a whiteboard is good because everybody gets to see, or maybe you're projecting something on screen and everybody gets to see it. So you're listing down all the ideas, right? So first of all, so that's the process. So listing of ideas. Okay. And you're one by one, you're just going, okay, everybody's saying, like, for example, if it's here in our class, then Aaron would give an idea. Maybe they would give two ideas. Maybe Prince would give three ideas. So what am I doing as a facilitator? I'm just listing it down. I'm just putting it on the board. Now, I'm not saying, maybe some ideas could be funny. Some ideas could be crazy ideas. Maybe you're saying, we need to go to the moon and have this event on the moon. Okay. Now, it could be really, crazy like that. But the thing is, not to shoot down any idea, okay? Not to shoot down any idea. Or when I say shoot down, I'm saying not to reject any idea at this point, right? We're not saying, okay, this is bad, this is good. Let's not do that. We are listing everything down. We're putting it in a chart, projecting it. Everybody's seeing it. So maybe you've got about 10 ideas or so. So the thing is to group those ideas. So that's the thing. Second one is to categorize. Categorize. So, which really means group it. So, certain ideas will come as a group. Okay, let's say people are saying, let's go to a resort. Okay, now all the ideas, resorts is one group. All the suggestions that came, like let's go to a resort or let's go to a place like that. So would be in that resort group. You categorize it, all the ideas. You pull all those ideas and put it under the resort group. Maybe some are saying we need to go to a fun resort. Maybe some are saying we need to go to a Wanderla kind of thing. There are a lot of sports kind of thing. I mean, a lot of games and water games and so on, rides and so on. So people are saying that. Then maybe people are saying, we need to go into the wild. We need to go into a forest and, like a wildlife kind of a resort, watch animals and, spend the time there. So that could be, everything could be grouped under resort. Okay. So categorize it. Or maybe there are other categories. So do that. And the third thing, so as we list down and categorize the ideas, even as we're listing down ideas, so the mistake we should not make is, first of all, just make it voluntary for people to share. Okay. And as a leader, you kind of encourage people to share. Okay. Encourage them to share, saying, okay, why don't you share? Do you have any thoughts? Encourage them. So don't make it like a sequence in the sense you're going around the table. Okay, five of us, six of us are sitting there. We're going in a sequence. Okay, you're saying, okay, this person next to this next to, so that fourth person knows, my turn is coming next. I know I'm just three people away, my turn is coming, so I better think of something fast. And they are forced, you know, they just, you know, so it doesn't really allow any creativity. They're just forced under pressure to say something, and they say something for the sake of saying it. Okay. Because it is their turn to say it, they're just saying it. Okay, they're not really thought through. So the thing is to, like, remove all that fear and everything and say, okay, guys, you know, feel free. And you share. So it's not a sequence kind of thing. Right? So it's not in turn like that. And also you're not forcing them. Okay, now I'm going to ask this person, you say something. I'm going to say that. It's free. It's in the sense, it's a lot of freedom and voluntarily. So that way people will actually think and come up with suggestions, come up with ideas. So that's something for us to remember. When we're asking for ideas, okay? So you list them, we categorize them. Then thirdly, now this is where we need to analyze. We're going to analyze it, meaning we're going to judge whether it's good or bad. Okay, so even before the process, it's good to tell the team, right? Hey guys, you know, feel free to share the ideas. Now, not all ideas are workable. And all ideas may not be carried out. Some ideas, we may not be able to do it now. It may be a great idea, but we may not be able to do something right now. Maybe we can do it later. It may not be, you know, it may not be possible to do right now. So the thing is this, I want you to share irrespective of all that, right? And no one should feel bad just because their idea is not taken or an idea is not carried out. Okay, we're going to do what's best for the organization, best for the team. So feel free to share. Okay, so then here we are analyzing, saying, okay, we've categorized it. We are looking at, you know, the resource group as one category. Okay, resource group is there. Then we have maybe another group which says the restaurant group. Okay, just do a lunch. Go to a restaurant. Do a lunch. Then maybe another group is saying, maybe what is it? Okay, maybe that group is saying maybe we should have a, you know, like a campfire plus like a barbecue night. Okay, so let's say, you know, all these categories, right? So you visit one category after another, okay? So, and you begin to, like, narrow down. Okay, hey guys, this is the money that we have. This is the budget, so we can't do this, you know, there is a resort thing. Okay, so that gets cancelled out. Then you say, okay, restaurant and campfire, okay, let's think about it. So you narrow it down and then further evaluate, saying, okay, I think restaurant works because campfire and barbecue, it means it needs to, you know, we need to do it outside. And right now the weather, we don't know. It's been very, very unpredictable. Sometimes there's a lot of rain, heavy rainfall, wind, which means campfire but barbecue cannot work. So if there's a restaurant, it's something indoors. Even if the weather is bad, we can still have a great time. So let's plan on going to a restaurant. And then maybe you can do another phase two of the brainstorming is listing down all the restaurants, you know, which are good, what kind of food preferences, and then you can make a decision. But you see, you know, people came out with these ideas. Okay, let's go to resort, let's go to the restaurant, let's go to, you know, let's have a campfire. You know, these are, you know, maybe even under that, there could be several. These are several categories, and under these categories, there were different ideas. So that idea, these many ideas would not have come if we had not involved the group in the decision-making process. If we had not involved the group in the brainstorming process, sorry. So all these options would not have come. So when it comes to solving, similarly, when it comes to, you know, this is a fun thing and people are most likely to participate and, you know, come up with ideas. But this would help in in solving problems creatively as well, like in addressing challenges, issues that we might have to sort creatively, right? So this is something that we can do. So just remember that when it comes to listing of ideas, don't reject any idea just because it seems very, very out of the way, right? Don't reject it. As soon as you hear it, don't reject it. List it down. Secondly, categorize it. It'll help, you know, put these ideas in boxes, right? So this box has all these ideas in this box are similar. So you categorize it. Then analyze. Okay, analyze the category. What works based on some of the realities, right? Like budget, time, you know, the effectiveness or whatever, you know, you can have your own yardstick or your own scale for evaluating the ideas. Then once you evaluate, then you can decide. And as a leader, you can also say, you know, I'm going to take a decision, but I want your ideas, and I'm going to decide, you know, the final decision, you know, I will have to take. So that's fine, right? Or the final decision, you know, we looked last session, it can be through consensus, it can be through voting, you know, based on the preferences and so on. So that'll, you know, that'll help. Okay. Now, another important aspect of team or group dynamics is, you know, not everything can be agreed to. Not everything is agreeable, right? It could be decisions. It could be, you know, some things that we decide to do. Not everything is agreeable. Not everything is something that we can say yes to if you're part of a team, right? Or if you're leading a team and somebody says, oh, you, it's not something that's agreeable. So we need to be able to disagree with that person or disagree with a group. We need to do it in an honorable manner, gracious manner, without really arguing about it. Okay, we can discuss, we can debate, but we don't need to necessarily argue about it. Okay, so when it comes to argument, there's a difference. When you're discussing, you are, you know, listing down, your emotions are kind of stable, right? You're not angry, you're not moody, you know, you're discussing it, you know, you're sharing some points, some experiences, and the other person is also sharing. So that's a good discussion, right? And a debate is something which is where you know, list down some pros and cons, meaning these are things that work, things that do not work. The other person also, or the other group is also lists down, okay, no, we think it's, these are things that are good, these things that are bad. So that's a debate. But when it comes to an argument, it's really not, you know, it's really not helpful, because, let me just put it down here. The argument doesn't help us because it is an exchange of diverging and opposite views, okay? But it's in a very angry, agitated manner. We argue it, okay? We're not debating it, we're not discussing it, but we are arguing about it. And then our emotions are stirred up, we are angry, agitated, upset. Now, an argument, somebody can win an argument, right? You can, because you're a senior person, maybe, or because you're the leader, you can win an argument. The other person says, may not, you know, continue. But then that doesn't help, because after, you might win the argument, but like the, you know, like you hear that saying, you can win an argument, but lose the person. You won something, but the person is not with you on the same page. Like, you've lost the person. They're not agreeing. They're not committed. Now, while we have won the argument, the situation has not really helped. know, it's not, it doesn't help you. You may have won the argument, but the person is not with you anymore. It has not helped you. So the thing is, we should be able to disagreeing without actually agreeing. Okay. So I just thought it would be helpful to watch this video and how we can disagree without arguing. Okay. So this is again on the whole thing of team discussions, team dynamics, or group discussions and group dynamics. Okay, let's watch this video.
Hi, I'm Edward Muzio, CEO of Group Harmonics, and I'm going to tell you how to disagree, but don't argue. Have you ever been in utter disbelief at somebody else's interpretation of something? Maybe you and a fellow manager are walking out of a meeting you just attended about company revenue. You get to talking, and next thing you know, you're wondering, did this guy go to the same meeting I went to? It's not uncommon, and if you don't need to agree on anything, it may not be a big deal. But let's say you and this manager have to come to some conclusion on what to tell your shared staff. You need to make sure your disagreement or your different perceptions don't turn into an argument or a situation where you're digging in your heels, getting emotional, and unable to come to resolution. To do that, you need to know something about where that reality came from. This is a model I call the five building blocks of reality. We start over here on the left with number one, information. You just attended a presentation about revenue, there was a presenter, and there was some data. And those two things together make up the objective information that you just saw. Next over here is the situation. This is all about context. In other words, who else was in the room? What was the history versus the current data that was presented? Whatever background information is important goes with the context. Now skip over here to the far right side. Number five, we have beliefs. I'll draw this as a thought bubble. It's really just the contents of your own mind. Maybe you believe your industry is a growth industry and your colleague believes it's a shrinking industry. Those are different beliefs. Those lead to different approaches. Approach is how you think things should be done. Your belief in a growth industry might lead you to take an aggressive approach toward new product releases. Your colleague's belief in shrinking profits might lead to a more conservative approach. Here in the middle, where everything comes together, we have the interpretation. The interpretation is the answer to the big question, so what? What does it all mean? As you can see, we have it, the information coming from out there, and we have you, what you brought to the party in here, coming together in interpretation. How do you use this model to keep your disagreement from becoming an argument? Two simple rules. First, you need to define the need for agreement. This means get very specific about what you need to agree on. You and this other manager need to come to some conclusion as to what to tell your staff. That's all. You don't need to agree on management philosophy or the future of the world. Keep it as narrow and as focused as you can. Second, use the five building blocks of reality to discuss what you're discussing. Be very overt. In other words, you're going to start with information. These are the facts I saw. These are the facts you saw. What else is on the table? We're talking objective facts here. Now let's move into situation. These were the contextual cues that were important to me. I noticed this was the history, etc. What did you see? Now move to interpretation. All of this led me to this conclusion. What was your conclusion? If you can get to your specific need for agreement here, stop here. Don't go any further if you don't have to, if you can get your agreement. If you have to, you can go on. You can move over here to approach and start talking about things like, I seem to be taking a more aggressive approach. You're taking a more conservative approach. How do we reconcile those? You can even go all the way to beliefs. If you do, be careful. It's tough to figure out your own beliefs, much less other people's, but you can try. You can certainly say, I tend to believe we're in a growth industry. What do you believe? And see where you get. It won't get you an answer every time, but if you focus on a well-defined need for agreement and you're clear using the model to discuss what you're discussing, you'll be more likely to keep your disagreement from becoming an argument, more likely to reach the agreement you need.
Yeah, so that's a very simple method of very, very simple method of disagreeing on something or agreeing on something, but not arguing. Okay, obviously it means that we need to have a level of maturity. We need to be mature. We need to make sure that we honor the other person. We're not putting down the other person, and we're not getting personal, right? Personal in the sense we're not saying things like, you're always like this, you're always late, you're always You know, you always don't think through, you know, all those always statements, you know, like these generalized statements. So we need to avoid those, right? So that will help us, right? That will really help us. Okay. And also those five building blocks of reality, you know, you can think about it. That will also really help us. So to be rational, to think through this, and to do this in a not in a very emotional way, but in a very rational way, right? In a mature way. So it'll help us, right? So this is these things are quite important for us as leaders, on decision making, on problem solving. And we will encounter these kind of things when we are dealing with groups, with people, and in teams and bigger teams, right? So it's important for us to learn these skills, to put to practice what we are learning, right? In order to get some good results, okay? Now, so we're going on to the next chapter, you know, which is chapter 11. Sorry, chapter 11 is what we can finish. We completed. Now we're going to chapter 12, which is about emotional and cultural intelligence. Emotional and cultural intelligence. Now, when it comes to intelligence, what does it mean? It just means that you are intelligent, right? You are informed, and you have a certain level of expertise. Just one second. Let me just type that out. Okay. Let me put that. When you say intelligence, it means that we have a certain level of or the ability to acquire knowledge, skills. Okay. Collection of knowledge and skills and the ability to acquire and apply. Okay, not just acquire, but apply. So we call that as intelligence or being intelligent, right? So when I say emotional intelligence, okay, so what is it? Or when we say cultural intelligence, what is it? Okay, so people call it as, when you say IQ, it means intelligence quotient.
Thank you.
It means intelligent quotient, which means the level or the standard or the level of intelligence that you have. Okay, so IQ is a level. So there are testings, you know, there are tests which tests your intelligence and how you, whatever, you know, knowledge that you have, how you apply it to solve problems. And they say, okay, this is your intelligence quotient, which means that you get a high score and, you know, your intelligent quotient is high. So similarly, you know, there is something called emotional quotient. Okay. When it comes to emotional intelligence, we have emotional quotient also. So let's look at what is emotional intelligence. Okay, so I'm just putting it on the chat again. excuse me. Emotional, when you say emotional intelligence, so we understood what intelligence is. When we say emotional intelligence, it is defined as the ability to be aware of, control, express emotions. Okay, it's also the ability to handle relationships with empathy. Okay, so that is it. Sometimes, you know, this is something that we grow in, like this awareness of emotions, the awareness of or the ability to even, you know, control our emotions and also to express our emotions. Like when a child, if you look at a child, right, a child will be upset for something. Okay, maybe the child is angry, maybe the child is hungry, upset, and it's crying. And so you ask the child, and the child is not afraid to express it. Right, the child is upset, so he or she, maybe it's a little boy. Okay, he's very upset. He's just walking around with a frown. He's not smiling. And he's just walking around with a long face, right? He's not, you know, and he says, okay, you ask him to do anything. Okay, come, sit. We're going to eat now. He say, no, I'm not going to eat. Why? Because he was upset about something. Maybe they didn't get him some toy or chocolate when they went shopping. And he's upset. And he's like, he's behaving badly, right? Now, an adult cannot be expected to behave in the same way. Maybe you got upset because, for whatever reason, you know, you got upset because you needed to get something and it was not done. But you cannot show, or you need to process your emotions in the right way, right? We need to process it in the right way and display it in the right way. Now, just because you are angry with a family member, you can't go to the office and be angry with your colleague, right? Because you're upset at the way things are at home, you know, maybe people are not carrying out their responsibilities, right? Maybe things needed to be washed, clothes need to be washed, things need to be put in the right way. And you have each family member to take care of each of those things, but they're not doing it, right? And you ended up doing it. Now you're upset with your family members. You're angry about it. Now you can show your anger to a fellow co-worker. Or when you're going on the road, you're going in your bike, you can't show that anger to someone who's on the road or in the bike next. You can't just go and do that, you know, on the bike, go and operate and then, you know, zigzag manner. You're going to put your life in danger and theirs in danger, right? So you can't do that. Now you need to process it, your emotion, be mature, and to also express your emotion in a mature manner. Now that is emotional intelligence, right? The ability to be aware of your emotions. Okay, I'm feeling a little upset. You're aware of it, right? And so therefore, because I'm upset, I'm not going to, you know, express my, you know, I'm a responsible person. Now I'm here as a leader, and a lot of people, you know, I'm leading, I'm responsible. So I'm not going to express the fact that I'm, you know, upset with the way things are at home. I'm not just going to do that. I'm going to do my job well, right? Because I'm a mature person. I'm not going to let that affect me in any way. I'm going to let those challenges affect me in any way. Yes, I will deal with those. And I will deal with it when I get back home. But now, right now, I'm here. I have some responsibilities. I will carry it out. Now, that's a mature way of processing our emotions and handling our emotions. Okay, so that's emotional intelligence. Okay, now when you have someone who is emotionally intelligent, you know, you as a leader, that talks about maturity, that talks about the ability for you to handle, you know, yourself well, then that person with that skill is more likely to be successful, right? Successful in solving things, successful in handling people, dealing with people, and more likely to be promoted, right? Noticed by the leadership and be promoted. Because why? You know, this person can actually, he's a mature person. He can handle decisions. He can handle, you know, people. Even if people are upset and angry, he or she knows how to actually not get upset, right? But to solve the problem, right? So you're also able to, you know, explain why, what you're thinking, etc. in a manner. Even though you might be upset about something, you're able to explain it well. So all these come under emotional intelligence, and these are very, very important. Okay, so let's look at some of the some aspects of emotional intelligence. Okay, one is self-awareness. Right, you're aware. Let me just put it again here. Let me just go through this. Self-awareness, that means that you as a person, you as a leader, you understand your feelings and emotions about certain or particular situations or issues, that you're aware. Now, if you're, you know, if something is upsetting you, you're first of all aware. Aware means knowing, right? You know it. Okay, this is upsetting me, or I'm getting upset for this reason. Many times people don't even know. Right? I'm feeling upset, but I don't know why I'm feeling upset. I'm feeling angry with someone, but I don't know why. Now that's not good, right? We need to be aware. We need to understand. You know, why am I feeling sad? Why am I feeling angry? We need to understand that. So that's emotional self-awareness. Okay, so that's one aspect of it. The other thing is also management, self-management. Okay, so if we looked at self-awareness, then the other thing is self-management, which means how I manage myself. Okay. Self-management means that emotionally I don't let emotions control me, but I control emotions, manage, I overcome. Means emotional control, which helps leaders not to be influenced or make decisions solely based on their emotions. So you see, now when I manage my emotions, now that puts me in a better place to make decisions. As a leader, you'll be asked to make decisions, and you have to make decisions, important decisions. Now, if I'm ruled by emotions, well, I'm in a good mood, so therefore I'm going to, you know, decide like this. Or I'm in a bad mood, therefore my decisions will be like this. Now, that's not the right way to make decisions, right? So, which means I have to manage myself, manage my emotions. I first of all, awareness. Secondly, managing of self. Okay. Now, that's again, very, very important. So, if I do that, then I'll be... One way it helps in making better decisions. Okay, so self-management. The other thing is also, it's called social awareness, which means that I'm aware of I have empathy for people, those who are around me. Okay. I understand what they're going through. I understand what they are. To be sensitive, right? So emotional are those who are able to have empathy for those who are working with them. You understand your own emotions, and you're aware of the emotions and feelings of others. You know, hey, this could upset this person, or this could, these could be the things that the person is going through. So when you understand, then it also helps. You know what happens in teams, right? And therefore, it helps what happens as an organization and how it impacts an organization, right? So this actually helps to be connected to employees and to work well as you empathize. You know, you like, for example, you know, sometimes it happens, like as a leader, sometimes you just let's say a person who's been working outside in the field, okay, field meaning, outside in the market. They're outside, they've been maybe visiting customers, maybe they're on a fundraising thing. So they've been, you know, traveling to different places, and they walked into the office just then. So to be emotionally aware is to give them some space, give them some time, like to catch their breath, drink some water, come and sit down and rest before you even ask them questions, right? Even before they have taken their helmet out, you know, or put their bags down, then if you, you know, just bombard them with questions, okay, where did you go? Where all did you go? That person is not even sitting down. So that person doesn't even, that doesn't really help the person. That doesn't really help the team. Right, which means this is just a small example. You know, you've not understood the need of the or the emotions of the person. Okay, so we'll stop here. We'll continue with emotional intelligence, and we'll also go to cultural, being culturally sensitive because people have different cultures from different cultures. So how to be sensitive to that? Okay, that is called the cultural intelligence. Right? So we look at that also. Okay, so we'll stop here, and we'll continue next class. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you.
Bye bye. Right. Bye bye.